Nuremberg, at the time, was hardly known to the great bulk of the travelling public. My wife and I, being in the second week of our honeymoon, naturally wanted someone else to join our party. So that when the cheery stranger Elias P. Hutchison turned up at the station at Frankfurt and casually remarked that he was going on to see the most all-fired old Methuselah of a town in Europe, we took the pretty broad hint and suggested that we should join forces. Straightway, Amelia and I found the pleasant benefit. Instead of quarrelling, as we had been doing, we now took every opportunity of spooning in odd corners, and much enjoyed the racy remarks of our transatlantic friend. The castle is seated on a rock dominating the town, and an immensely deep fosse guards it on the northern side. The ditch has not been used for centuries, and now its base is spread with tea gardens and orchards. A little to our right rose the torture tower, which was, and is, perhaps, the most interesting place in the city. In one of our pauses, we leaned over the wall of the moat and looked down. Below us was a pretty sight, a great black cat lying stretched in the sun, whilst round her gambolled prettily a tiny black kitten. Elias P. Hutchison, in order to help the play, stooped and took from the walk a moderate-sized pebble.
"I will drop it near the kitten, and they will both wonder where it came from."
"Oh, be careful," said my wife. "You might hit the dear little thing."
"Not me, ma'am," said Elias P.
He leaned over and held his arm out at full length and dropped the stone. It fell with a sickening thud right on the kitten's head and shattered out its little brains then and there. The black cat cast a swift upward glance, and we saw her eyes like green fire fixed an instant on Elias P. Hutchison. And then her attention was given to the kitten, which lay still whilst a thin red stream trickled from a gaping wound. Suddenly she seemed to realise that it was dead and again threw her eyes up at us. I shall never forget the sight, for she looked the perfect incarnation of hate. Then she made a wild rush up the wall as if to reach us, but further added to her horrible appearance, for she fell on the kitten and rose with her black fur smeared with its blood. Amelia turned quite faint, and I had to lift her back from the wall. Then I went back to Hutchison, who stood without moving, looking down on the angry cat below.
"Well, I guess that's the savagest beast I ever see. Except once, when an Apache squaw had an edge on a half-breed, what they nicknamed Splinters. And she followed Splinters more than 3 years, till at last the braves got him and handed him over to her. They did say that no man, white or Injun, had ever been so long a-dying under the tortures of the Apaches."
Whilst he was speaking, the cat was continuing her frantic efforts to get up the wall.
"I do declare that that poor critter seems quite desperate. There, there, poor thing, it was all an accident. Though that won't bring back your little one to you. Say, Colonel..."
It was a pleasant way he had to bestow titles freely.
"I hope your wife don't hold no grudge against me on account of this unpleasantness."
Then we all went again to the wall and looked over. The cat was sitting on her haunches as though ready to spring. Indeed, the very instant she saw him, she did spring, and with a blind, unreasoning fury, which would have been grotesque, only that it was so frightfully real. Amelia said to Elias P. in a warning voice, "That animal would try to kill you if she were here. Her eyes look like positive murder." He laughed out jovially.
"Excuse me, ma'am," he said, "but I can't help laughing. Fancy a man that has fought grizzlies and Injuns being careful of being murdered by a cat."
Here he slapped his pistol pocket at the back of his lumbar region.
"Why, soon have you worried, I'll shoot the critter right here."
And so we went on and crossed the little wooden bridge leading to the castle gateway. As we crossed the bridge, we saw the cat again down below us. Hutchison laughed as he looked down at her and said,
"Goodbye, old girl. Sorry I endured your feelings, but you'll get over it in time."
We were the only visitors who had entered the torture tower that morning. So, at least, said the old custodian. The lower chamber where we entered was filled with incarnate darkness. When we came up through the open trap in the corner of the chamber overhead, Amelia held on to me so tightly that I could actually feel her heartbeat. I was not surprised at her fear, for this room was even more gruesome than that below. Round the chamber were many implements of torture, which made one's heart ache to see. Chairs full of spikes, which gave instant and excruciating pain. Racks, belts, boots, gloves, collars, and many, many other devices for man's injury to man. But the central object in this chamber of horrors was the engine known as the Iron Virgin. It was a rudely shaped figure of a woman, something of the Bell order, or to make a closer comparison, of the figure of Mrs. Noah in the children's ark. A rope was fastened to a ring in the front of the figure and was drawn through a pulley, fastened on the wooden pillar which sustained the flooring above. The custodian, pulling this rope, showed that a section of the front was hinged like a door at one side. We then saw that the engine was of considerable thickness, leaving just room enough inside for a man to be placed. It was only, however, when we came to look at the inside of the door that the diabolical intention was manifest to the full. Here were several long spikes, broad at the base and sharp at the points, placed in such a position that when the door should close, the upper ones would pierce the eyes of the victim, and the lower ones his heart and vitals. The sight was too much for poor Amelia, and this time she fainted dead off, and I had to place her on a bench outside till she recovered. When we got back to the chamber, we found Hutchison still opposite the Iron Virgin.
"Well, I guess I've been learning something here while Madame has been getting over her faint. It appears to me that we're a long way behind the times on our side of the big drink. I guess, but I'll get in that box a minute just to see how it feels."
"Oh, no. No, no," said Amelia. "It is too terrible."
"I guess, ma'am, nothing's too terrible to the exploring mind. I spent a night inside a dead horse whilst a prairie fire swept over me in Montana Territory. I've not funked an odd experience yet, and I don't propose to begin now."
We saw that he was set on the experiment, so I said, Well, hurry up, old man, and get through it quick."
"All right, General," said he. "I dare say this old galoot can rise some string and tie me up according to sample."
This was said interrogatively to the old custodian, but the latter shook his head. The American thrust a gold piece into his hand, saying,
"Take it, pard, it's your pot."
When the upper part of his body was bound, Hutchison said,
"Hold on a moment, George. I guess I'm too heavy for you to tote into the canister. You just let me walk in, and then you can wash up regarding my legs."
Whilst speaking, he had backed himself into the opening, which was just enough to hold him. Then the custodian completed his task by tying the American's feet together so that he was now absolutely helpless and fixed in his voluntary prison. He seemed to really enjoy it, and the incipient smile which was habitual to his face blossomed into actuality as he said,
"Now, George, you just begin to let this door down slow on me. I want to feel the same pleasure as the other jays had when those spikes began to move towards their eyes."
"Oh, no, no, no," broke in Amelia hysterically. "It is too terrible. I can't bear to see it. I can't, I can't." But the American was obdurate.
"Say, Colonel," said he, "why not take Madame for a little promenade? I wouldn't hurt her feelings for the world, but now that I am here, having come 8,000 miles, wouldn't it be too hard to give up the very experience I've been pining and panting for?"
Once more, the resolution that is born of curiosity triumphed, and Amelia stayed holding tight to my arm and shivering whilst the custodian began to slacken slowly, inch by inch, the rope that held back the iron door. Hutchison's face was positively radiant as his eyes followed the first movement of the spikes.
"Well," he said, "I guess I've not had enjoyment like this since I left New York. Slow there, George. Don't you rush this business."
The custodian must have had in him some of the blood of his predecessors in that ghastly tower, for he worked the engine with a deliberate and excruciating slowness which after 5 minutes began to overcome Amelia. I saw her lips whiten and felt her hold upon my arm relax. I looked around an instant for a place whereupon to lay her, and when I looked at her again, found that her eye had become fixed on the side of the Virgin. Following its direction, I saw the black cat crouching out of sight. Her green eyes shone like danger lamps in the gloom of the place, and their colour was heightened by the blood which still smeared her coat and reddened her mouth. I cried out, "The cat! Look out for the cat!" For even then she sprang out before the engine. Her eyes blazed with ferocity. Her hair bristled out till she seemed twice her normal size.
"Darn if the squaw ain't got on all her war paint. You just give her a shove off if she comes any of her tricks on me. Now, easy there, George. Don't you slack that rope or I'm euchred."
At this moment, Amelia completed her feint. Whilst attending to her, I saw the black cat crouching for a spring and jumped up to turn the creature out. But at that instant, with a sort of hellish scream, she hurled herself, not as we expected, at Hutchison, but straight at the face of the custodian. With a yell of sheer terror, the man leaped back, dropping as he did so the rope which held back the iron door. I jumped for it, but was too late, for the cord ran like lightning through the pulley block, and the heavy mass fell forward from its own weight. As the door closed, I caught a glimpse of our poor companion's face. His eyes stared with a horrible anguish, as if dazed, and no sound came from his lips. And then the spikes did their work. Happily, the end was quick, for when I wrenched open the door, they had pierced so deep that they had locked in the bones of the skull, through which they had crushed and actually tore him, it, out of his iron prison, till, bound as he was, he fell at full length with a sickly thud upon the floor, his face turning upwards as he fell. I rushed to my wife, lifted her up and carried her out, for I feared for her very reason if she should wake from her faint to such a scene. I laid her on the bench outside and ran back. Leaning against the wooden column was the custodian, moaning in pain whilst he held his reddening handkerchief to his eyes. And sitting on the head of the poor American was the cat, purring loudly as she licked the blood which trickled through the gashed sockets of his eyes.